episode 255 of the Global From Asia podcast, talking accounting and e-commerce. Let's do it.
Welcome to the Global From Asia podcast, where the daunting process of running an international business is broken down into straight up actionable advice. And now, your host, Michael Michelini.
Thank you, everybody, for choosing to download and listen or stream Global From Asia, episode 255, recording in Shenzhen, China, my old home base. And this is an intense few days. As I said last week, we are moving to Guangzhou for the cross-border summit, October 22nd, 23rd. I was there for one night and an intense, mostly full day. And for those that know the, what is it called, Greater Bay Area or the PRD, Pearl River Delta or South China, probably know the whole Hong Kong, Guangzhou, Dongguan, Shenzhen mania of trains and buses and taxis. And while it's intense, it's a pretty amazing how much you can get around this huge landmass with, I don't even know how many people, 30 million total? Some more than 30, you know, each city's like 15, 20 million, say times three or four, you know, it's insane. Well, but so it's pretty amazing we can get around without a car, you know, in Chiang Mai. It's my wife that drives. I don't like to drive, but you know, kind of almost have to have a car there, especially with the family. But anyway, we're really excited. We're basically locked down a venue for the 22nd, 23rd of October. We're going all in, focusing on this as our main event. You know, we did some workshops, meetups, roundtables, some online boot camps and things like that, and decided to fully focus our efforts on one great event for the community. So if you do enjoy what you're listening to and you want to find a way to contribute to the cause, but not just a donation, it's a pretty valuable event. So we'd love to see you there. It's going to be amazing. We have so many amazing speakers already, and I'm a little bit backlogged. We've gotten totally overwhelmed with people that want to speak, and we're not ignoring people. We just are trying to figure out a process of vetting all these applications of people that want to share their amazing experiences and knowledge. And it's pretty good people. It's different sellers and traders and service providers and experts within, of course, Amazon and cross-border e-commerce. But anyway, I'll slow down a little bit. But we just, you know, it was great to catch up with some people in the community the last few days here. It's the home base, or my original base, for quite a few years. So this week's show, we have talking about accounting and bookkeeping. You know, I know some of you are like cringing, actually, like me. And Bean Ninjas has been doing really great. I actually was on their, we'll be on their podcast in the near future with Merrill, the host and founder there. And today we have Wayne Richard. He's a Biz Dev Networking expert and bookkeeping expert. And we chat a little bit about, try to stay within this whole cross-border world of accounting, which is extremely important because you're dealing with so many currencies, so many different banks, probably, or, you know, that, I think this is honestly really important to try to take control of is your accounting, because a lot of people look at the top line on their Amazon or the top line of their business, but what really matters is the stuff that happens after the top line. You know, how much are you actually spending? Where is it going? And also in the top line, which of those products or which of those services that you sell is working the best and making you the most money? So we talk about all different kinds of conversations. We also share a little bit some of the experiences. He also loves working with online teams. He works remotely too. So we chat about that as well. And it's a good episode, and I hope it inspires you to take better control of your finances and your books, because I don't like it either, you know, I'll be honest. I'm not a books person, but it's important, and I really hope you take that serious and hopefully you learn some things in today's show. And let's tune in. Enjoying the show and want to support our sponsors, GoRemit.hk is one of our key sponsors here at the show. They are a cross-border payment solution provider for your Hong Kong bank to paying in Southeast Asia and mainland China for suppliers, virtual assistants, paying your rent, paying damages for crazy things you might have done and partying. I won't get into my own story, but you know, we really appreciate them supporting this show, and it keeps the show going and keeps the team going. We actually have quite a bit of people to help make this podcast. Of course, you hear my voice and our guests, but there's amazing people, a lot in the Philippines, some in China, Hong Kong, other parts of the world that help make this show happen, and we use GoRemit to pay them. So if you do want to use solutions for your VAs or your online team or your suppliers in China, definitely check out www.goremit.hk. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to this new interview. It's going to be a fun one. You know, we got Wayne Richard from Bean Ninjas. Thanks for coming on, Wayne.
Absolutely, Mike. Thanks for having me. Excited to chat.
Yeah, we've already been doing a little bit of pre-interview talk, and I feel like we should have. I'm like, hit to record. Because it's fascinating already before we even got started. We've known of, you know, of course, Bean Ninjas. I'm sure a lot of listeners have heard of your company. And do you want to give, before we jump in, do you want to give a little background about yourself and the company?
Sure. So my name is Wayne Richard. I'm the director of global operations, and I lead the sales activities at Bean Ninjas. Bean Ninjas is a zero bookkeeping, training, and small business financial education and reporting company. We have a global dispersed team and service clients around the globe.
Awesome. Yeah, I mean, I was recently on, at least interviewed on your show. You guys have a podcast as well, and you are practicing what you preach in a way. You have the online teams. A lot of our listeners are cross-border sellers and doing international business. So I'm sure that today's show, there's so much we could talk about. I mean, it's going to be hard probably to keep it in one show. Maybe we could have a follow-up. But I think, I was just catching up about our listeners. I think a lot of them are using this keyword cross-border, which means I think we would define cross-border as between two countries, right? Like usually it's buying in one country, selling in another.
Absolutely.
Go ahead.
I'm seeing a lot of similarities. I mean, I see your audience very focused on building e-commerce businesses, but as we were talking about earlier, the accounting space is in the same trajectory where there are no longer those boundaries of having to have an office downtown and only having an opportunity to service those clients that could have a physical presence with you in your office. Through technology, we now have the opportunity to service clients across the globe.
Yeah, it's an amazing time now. I mean, we have amazing people on our team here at Global from Asia and our other businesses that work, you know, around the world that, it's crazy, actually. It's amazing. The cool thing, my favorite part of it, actually, just I don't want to get into a big rant, but that whole entitlement problem of people in certain countries thinking they're born in a certain country, they should be guaranteed some kind of a job or opportunity. That kind of always makes me a little bit, I'm not going to go specific people, but even in my friend network, you know, they think like, you know, that because they're in a certain location, they should be granted certain benefits, which I don't believe in. I think, you know, we should be compensated and rewarded based on our ability, not our birthright. But anyway.
And how exciting is it that you can now source the best talent for the specific job you're looking to hire? Exactly. Before, you were limited to those people that were within a reasonable commute into your office space. Now you have an opportunity to put out a very specific job description, have a very clear outline of the roles and responsibilities you're looking to fill, and you have an audience across the globe. Yeah. So you can spend time truly getting the best talent. And oftentimes when you go cross border for a rate that's much less than what you could find for resources within your own city.
It's true. It's amazing. I mean, I think listeners too have been doing it for a while, and you've been doing it a while. I feel like that whole world is flat is coming pretty hyper fast. You know, I've seen prices kind of going up and going down. You know, I've seen that flattening happening. I mean, it's still a huge opportunity, but the gap is starting, I don't want to say close, but yeah, I mean, I think it is starting to really flatten because, you know, these good people that might be in quote unquote cheap places, their prices have been going up. I mean, I think you might agree, but I mean, it's pretty amazing to see that even happening.
Absolutely. I'll touch base on one of my favorite parts. I think we talked a little earlier about our families, and for me, it's I'll spend the end of the day with my globe, and I'll show my kids where I've spoken with people throughout the day and had meetings. Mm. And in some days, I may have spoken with people in seven different countries, truly on the other side of the world, on the other hemisphere. And having grown up the way I did in a very blue collar small town in New England, the world is not much larger than New England. And to think now that I have the ability to have face-to-face via web conversations, meetings with people clearly on the other side of the world is pretty mind-blowing.
It is. It's, I mean, just like this exact show, right? Like, I'm in Thailand, you're in Arizona now, I think, right?
And that's right.
I don't even know. I don't even ask people anymore. Like, and then somebody's going to be listening to this, you know, who knows, somewhere. And I think we got listeners, you know, in South Africa or something, for example. I think Phil listens and some others. And it's just mind-blowing. And what's, I think it's scary for the lazy people, right? Like, I don't want to get on that rant again, but if you're just going to sit in your laurels and just say, I'm just going to like stick with the traditional jobs or opportunities in my region, and yeah, I mean, you're going to keep falling behind. So I think people got to get off their butt and learn and grow their skills and build a business or make their own opportunity. So I kind of want to focus today. There's so much we could talk about. I'm fascinated by this, but I think we want to talk a little bit about what you probably see on a day-to-day basis is a bookkeeping for cross-border businesses. You know, Amazon is taking over the world and there's these sellers making millions, but I think it just gets really complex in a way. Maybe obviously it might be hard to do on a generic podcast without, you know, knowing people's cases, but I think we can talk about some tips and tricks for bookkeeping with somebody, the typical Amazon seller that's, or business owner that's buying from a factory in China, maybe has a Hong Kong company or has maybe a Singapore company or even a US company, and then they're selling in America. There's obviously people doing Europe. I mean, it's fascinating to me. And, you know, I just think maybe you can give us, we can talk about, or I can ask you some more specific questions, but I think it's complex, you know, it's getting more and more common. More and more people are doing it. I mean, I remember first figuring that out in like 2006 still in my day job in New York. But, you know, do you want me to give you some specific, maybe we can give an overview of what you're seeing now, and then we can kind of have this conversation. Yeah.
I guess I'll start with a story of the most amazing clients that come to us. So I have a unique ability because of my role in sales to hear the startup stories of the customers that Bean Ninjas goes on to support. But also as our director of global operations, I maintain the client relationship. So across about my 3 years in supporting Bean Ninjas, I've been able to see people that have come to us with an idea that in a goal of building a company, and in 2 or 3 years being in a position to exit that company for life-changing money. And in looking at what they've done to become successful, I see some key things. I think first, from day one, build your business financial structure and organize your bookkeeping as if you were positioning to sell. And what I mean by that is have systems in place to store and organize source documents, purchase orders, executed invoices. Have a place that you record your income and expenses, not simply a bank statement where you're seeing net deposits, but be in a position to understand what your true top line gross sales are. Split from those your relative expenses, for instance, for Amazon, for FBA fees, for storage charges, for ad spend, so that you can, one, while executing and operating in your business, you can be strategic about where you're spending money. But also, when you are looking to sell your business, you will be asked to present financials. And if you can come to the table with clear financials that have source documents that support areas of spend that show growth very clearly in things like top line sales, in a strategy where you've been effective in terms of spending within the business, and a clear understanding of what expenses could be removed from the business when you exit, you position yourself for a higher sales price down the road.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, there's that buzzword, I was waiting for you to say it, but working on your business, not in your business. But I think that's another big goal that we should all have as business owners. So much of us love to get into details. I've had critical feedback from even podcast guests and friends that I love getting my hands dirty too, personally. But I think we have to realize we have to step back and look at it holistically. And I guess the best way is these numbers, right? That's really what, whether you're selling or you're a business owner, have business partners, you know, there's KPIs is a big buzzword, or you having metrics that you can then really grow your business and think about it strategically as a business owner rather than as a I guess you can say employee, or even employees should have numbers, right? But you know, if you want to really be a business owner, you have to know your numbers, I would say.
It goes back to the adage, you can't manage what isn't measured. And in bookkeeping and in financial reporting, you have the ability to look at your financials as both a history lesson. So bookkeeping is basically just the organization of your transactions to help tell you where you've spent your money. And I like to relate it to, you know, personal finance philosophies like Dave Ramsey, and like there's other the profit first methodology, and also even with Rich Dad Poor Dad, you know, it's not enough just to understand where your money has gone or where your money is coming in from, but it's important to be proactive and look at your numbers and have a future focus to tell your money where you want it to go. So without having metrics or an understanding and narrating that story that's coming out of those financial reports, you can't strategically plan for where your business wants to go. You're almost just operating looking in the rearview mirror rather than a bit looking into the crystal ball, if you will, but doing so with some very sound guidance through the metrics that you've understood.
Yep. Agreed. So I think I can have some questions I can imagine some listeners having. You know, multi-currency is such a challenge. Is there some tips you can give on cross-border businesses maybe buying from a factory? I guess usually it's a little bit easier because the factory is usually quoting FOB US dollar. Usually you're operating in US dollar, but is there any strategies or tactics or something we could maybe chat about? Or
I can speak more specifically to tools. So I think what's important is once you have your business organized where you have an ability to operate in multi-currency, where you've established banking in multiple countries, or you have the sufficient Stripe accounts to manage the transactions that need to be managed within your daily operations, you need a place where you can record that. So at B Ninjas, we are an exclusive provider and utilize only the Xero bookkeeping and accounting cloud solution. And we found that Xero supports multi-currency, allows for you a place where you can understand the balances and the transactions that are running through your various accounts, but also report those multi-currency accounts and transactions in a way where your reporting is populated in a single currency. And it's typically the currency in the country that you're operating or you're licensed your business out of. So it gives you a level platform to understand how one area of spend might be measured against another.
Agreed. Yeah, I mean, that's just sometimes you just feel like your head's upside down. I mean, I'm literally overwhelmed sometimes with paying a peso bot RMB, Hong Kong dollar, and US dollar is kind of what I'm operating in almost at least monthly. So it's true. I mean, having a base currency is definitely critical. And then is that normally?
And it's just natural when you start seeing, you know, Hong Kong dollars your mind automatically thinks it's a huge number. Mm. You see all the zeros and you've got to process a little bit. Okay, that FX rate is this, and you have some emotion that originally goes in. So I think when you have an opportunity to put everything into one currency, you have a level framework where you can begin to measure and compare areas of spend against one another.
Agreed. And then there's, you know, what are some other things? I'm just trying to think of, you know, even we have a case study for us being a seller. I guess it's a little bit easier with a U.S.-based company, you think? Because it's all settling in dollars. I don't think there's multi-currency in banks in America that I know of. Maybe I'm wrong.
I think it's similar in terms of the complexity of managing cross-border companies headquartered or founded in different countries. We support clients with Hong Kong limited corporations, and we support clients across many countries. And really what it comes down to is having a system in place, executing across that system with processes that can be replicated, can be given to staff members to manage. But also it's just cross your T's and dot your I's. If you have an opportunity or you're provided a source document, utilize tools like HubDoc to store those documents and feed them directly into Xero. Those tools even work in multi-currency where you can push documents like invoices that have been paid or receipts that you've received and feed them into your accounting solution Xero directly from these other receipt and expense management solutions.
Makes sense. Yeah, I mean, like we've been, you know, it's talking since the beginning of our show today. Yeah, I mean, leveraging technology, right? I think that's one of the beautiful things. I mean, it wasn't even that many years ago. I remember fumbling with QuickBooks installation on my laptop and having like a local data file that I had to like share to an accountant. Like I'm dating myself, but I remember that was when I was still in New York and I had to go to an accountant's office in 2007, and then it was this huge file. I remember you had to like export for an accountant and send to them, and I remember that. I mean, nowadays it's like you said with Xero, or you know, I know you guys are exclusive on that, but there's other options too. But you know, it's some now there's ways of sharing pretty easily, and it's and then like you mentioned HubDoc and others, just by having the data in recorded at least, you know, is essential.
Absolutely. And collaborating. I mean, we have opportunities now where we can share access to a tax accountant in a given country and still have the opportunity because of the ability and the access through technology. We can support the bookkeeping side and the accounting piece of our customer's business, but those areas that become complex or require a significant understanding and discipline within that field, such as tax, we can collaborate globally with a tax accountant within any given country and share details around what's occurring within the business. At the end of the day, regardless of where a company operates, there's cash coming into the business that's through income, and there's money going out of the business that are expenses. The complexity comes in your country-specific tax rules that we can collaborate with any tax accountant via web chat as if we were sitting across the table. It's pretty amazing.
It's true. So normally, I know you guys obviously have your service, which we recommend, and we can talk about more maybe some how that works. But I mean, would you say weekly, monthly? I guess it depends on the volume of the transactions. I mean, is there some guideline for frequency of, you know, maybe bookkeeping or updating your records?
Yeah, I think there's a few best practices. I think you should be in each of your bank accounts reconciling your transactions. And what that means is categorizing them against your various income and expense accounts each week. You should be reviewing things like payables, so bills that require you to action payment every other week. And you should also be managing your personal payroll. I think one topic that would be important for your listeners to understand are strategies around paying yourself. I think often people get into business and they see the vast amounts of softwares and programs that they can link into their website and within their analytics and forget that their business will fail to operate if they are not satisfied and rewarded for their contributions within their business. So it's important to understand what your value is within your business and begin recognizing that value through payments to yourself, whether or not through wages or distributions, depending on what your corporate structure allows. And there's a great methodology, and I alluded to the book earlier, but Profit First by Mike Michalowicz suggests that you even do that first. So you begin taking your cash receipts and allocating a certain percentage of that for owner's compensation. And a quote that was shared was, most people say, well, that's not putting the client first. That might be a bit of greed, but the best way to support your clients is to keep your business running. Great. And one of the ways to ensure your business runs is to make sure that you're providing for those living expenses and you're satisfied by the return that you're getting for your time and investment into your business.
Agreed. I mean, I'm going back to back in the day, but I remember that kind of flashback memory, like day one of making your book, making your business plan is paying yourself, right? And so many of us are, the bootstrapping, hustling entrepreneur that, but I think it's true. You'll respect what you do and respect your business more if you just put that line item for you to be able to be at least comfortable enough to focus on what you're working on.
And you'll also be very strategic on the things you spend money on. I think it's easy if you see these big lump sum net deposits post in your account and you have a feeling like you have all this money to go out and spend. But once you start allocating some towards yourself and you begin managing your expenses on what's left, you begin to think, and I'm a family guy. And for me, it was easy. In starting out in business, it was, do I want to spend on more sophisticated CRM solution or do I want to put my daughter in dance class? Well, the answer was easy. I said, well, I'm going to put my daughter in her dance class and then I'm going to work my butt off to earn more money and be able to afford that CRM solution when the money's there. But I very much look at spend as identifying and making sure you capture certainly those things that you need to have, but the nice to have things, make sure that you're taking care of yourself before introducing a lot of those.
Agreed. And there's no, I think especially the younger me was like, I want to dump everything back into this business. I want to grow it. I don't know what Gary Vee would say about this, but the hustle, the don't sleep, the make it happen. But yeah, I think if you're not taking care of yourself, if you're not taking care of yourself and you're not healthy and you're not able to, feel comfortable, I mean, it's you're going to hurt your business, I think, in the long term.
I think you'll burn out. I think many of us come to these paths where we have other opportunities. We could otherwise earn more money in more traditional settings in the near term, in the early months. And it does take a bit of grind and it takes some hustle. I'm not saying pay yourself an equivalent salary, but make sure you're considering yourself in the mix of expenses. Because what we often see is people build businesses over years and you'll ask them, what they've taken out and what they've rewarded themselves. And it's often little to nothing or even less than what they were making. Yes, there's something to be said about the intrinsic value of doing something you're passionate about and growing something from nothing. But also, you need to be mindful of setting a line in the sand and saying it's okay to recognize myself as an important contributor, just as you would when you're starting to assess and hiring others to come in and support your business.
Makes sense. So let's maybe go to some more of these tips and tricks. So what are you seeing like as some common, you mentioned tools or tactics that maybe cross-border e-commerce, cross-border business owners are using?
Sure. So I think the more successful ones, what they're doing is they're identifying profitability by sales channel. I think that's critical. I think it's important as an e-commerce seller to understand what platforms are you doing well in and what platforms are you killing it in. It can then allow for you to better adjust your strategy and ad spend into those areas that are most successful for you and your business. Otherwise, I think other tactics that those successful e-commerce clients are doing is they're recognizing and they have an understanding of the difference between inventory and cost of sales. So often we see clients come to us and they have no inventory recognized in their balance sheet. And there's a number of ways you can do that. And I don't want to bore everyone with the accounting, but I feel like at a minimum, you should understand the goods that are in transit and you should understand the goods that are in a warehouse ready for sale. And then within that, you should also be adjusting your financials to allocate to expense an equivalent amount of expense to those sales that you've generated. And there's a number of technical ways you can work up and understand what that number is. But it's important that you're not simply recognizing your expenses based on the bills that you're paying for these large areas of spend within your business in 1 month and having your sales come 2-3 months later and not having any expense recognized against it.
Makes sense. Something crossed my mind is obviously Amazon, I'm sure a lot of your clients are like 100% FBA or maybe, yeah, I was talking to somebody just the other day, they're, you know, people trying to build out Shopify, build out off Amazon, but I'm sure, you know, at least people I talk to are still heavily in FBA. And I wonder if, I don't know if this is something you can reveal or not, but you say profitability. I mean, I'm wondering, Amazon is probably a volume, is also probably profitable, but they probably, would you be able to reveal or share or know about, like, what would you say most people are profitable versus, because I think usually if people sell on their own, like, say, website, shopping cart, it might be more profitable, might not be as volume as an FBA. Is that something you would
say? That's exactly right. That's exactly right. I mean, you're going to lose 30%+ margin due to various Amazon fees. So I think one other tip I would give is understand how to extract your payment detail report from Seller Central and begin to work either through Excel pivot tables or through tools like A2X to understand the split of expenses from your true gross sales numbers within Amazon. Because then you'll have visibility to your storage fees and your FBA charges. And within that, you'll have a true sense of the volume sales. But as you mentioned, the expense that goes into operating within Amazon, it's an amazing platform. It's going to get you exposure that you wouldn't otherwise have. But there's also cost for that. Absolutely, you're going to make higher margins on selling direct on your website if you're priced competitively, but you're not going to have as great a reach in selling to those people and having that awareness of brand.
Agreed. And then I think just a follow-up point, I know you're not a broker, but I'm sure you probably deal with brokers. Like obviously there's a few we know in our networks. But usually I think buyers are looking for multi-channel, right? And I think a real brand would have, I don't know, what would you, do you have any insights about that?
I think it's like anything else. What if one day Amazon decided to private label your product and they began to pump in ad spend that represented their product well above yours? You don't want to be held hostage by one sales channel. It's important to be across multiple sales channels so that in the event either there was a competitor that started to outsell you. Or I even had a client where there was an individual that was able to access their account that was changing their key search terms, and it dropped their rankings to a place where it nearly sank their business. And because of the processing time that it took to get things fixed, it nearly destroyed them. So you want to have opportunities where you're getting exposure, you're achieving sales across numerous platforms. So in the event that one platform changes their algorithms or has a limitation on how you're able to put your products in front of customers, you continue to maintain the growth that you've had year over year.
Mm-hmm. Agreed. And is there like a percent? I heard a broker saying like, you know, at least 30% off Amazon to be considered a true brand. Don't know if that's something you would agree with.
Or... No, I don't have that type of insight.
Yeah, I mean,
that'd be an interesting conversation.
Yeah, I'm thinking it's something on my list. And then I guess the next question is, so going off Amazon is hard, though. I mean, both on the marketing as well as not just the marketing, but the fulfillment. I know you could use FBA fulfillment for non-Amazon channel, but of course they're expensive, and why would you do that? But, you know, I think the next challenge of going multi-channel, in addition to bookkeeping, but I think I want to tie it back to bookkeeping, is using a third-party fulfillment center outside of Amazon. That gets into even more complexity, multiple warehouses. I mean, that topic is massive and a huge headache. I don't know if you want to have insights. I mean, from maybe a bookkeeping standpoint, maybe of multiple warehouses, multiple fulfillment technology channels. I mean,
it relates to bookkeeping, and it's something that I feel people should become aware of because the rules are changing. And it's around sales tax. So where you begin to store products in various warehouses in numerous states, you begin to define what's called nexus and have nexus within those states. And there was a ruling in South Dakota, and it was the Wayfair case, that began to recognize that if you had goods stored in a certain state and you sold to customers within those states, if you achieved a certain volume of sales, then you were required to collect and remit back to the state sales tax. So this was always a very gray area in e-commerce, and is becoming more and more clear because more states are beginning to follow suit. And where you have nexus, you're required to file. So in some cases, you may have a requirement in an administrative burden to begin remitting and filing sales tax returns each month or even on a quarterly basis to 17 or 23 different states. So it's something that plays right into that distribution center model you were talking about.
Agreed. Yeah, I mean, it's just so much really to talk about, but there's, I think there's others too. I mean, as far as the technical part, I mean, I think there's some sellers, and I'll be honest, sometimes even me, I mean, we just kind of do like a monthly net of our total, and we're not breaking it down always, but the more granular you can get, right, of per item, per, you know, the profitability of each item, and then, you know, there's FIFO and FIFO. I'm honestly one of these bad people about bookkeeping, but you know, then there's
bore your audience to death.
Yeah, there's first in, first out, last in, last first out. I mean, but then, you know, of course, the inventory tracking is, I know sellers want to know exactly which item is the most profitable, right? And which channel. And you can get, so you mentioned pivot tables, and there's obviously softwares like Xero and others. Yeah. I mean, that can get down to that level. I mean, but then you're also kind of reliant on your fulfillment center's data tracking and things like that.
And I think what's important is cover the basics first. I think, yes, there is an interest, and sellers want that level of detail, but you can't get there if you don't first understand how much money are you making in your business in a given year. How much of that money you're making in your business is coming through, as we mentioned earlier, each of your sales channels? Which of, you know, how much of your money are you spending as a percentage of sales on things that will drive growth in your business, like ad spend? You know, I think it's important to understand those things, like profitability by SKU, but only after you've had a clear understanding of the big picture. And I think what we're finding is people fail that step first. So we try to take a step back and say, okay, let's get you organized and achieve step one before we look to get to step 27.
Agreed. All right. Well, this has been a great talk. And I know we're both dads and there's kids around. And is there any last points? I mean, of course, we'll talk about your service too, but is there, before we get into maybe talking about how you guys work, is there any other last points you'd want to bring up? I think that was kind of like, seems like a really good one you just said, but I'll give you the chance to add something.
Well, I think I've covered most of the bookkeeping strategy, systems, process, conversations. I am most excited to be a dad.
Yeah.
And I think we talked earlier, but we haven't shared yet. I'm the father of five.
Wow.
So my wife and I had two children, and we were then surprised with triplets. So I now have five-year-old triplets, and the opportunities that have been made available to me in being more entrepreneurial and working with a global distributed business and with a team that's dispersed across, I believe now, 8 different countries, has given me the flexibility to really be involved and intentional in the time that I spend with each of my kids. I'm that dad at the field trips. I'm that dad at each and every dance recital, t-ball practice, and school play that's out there. And the reason I can do that is because of the flexibility that I now have in being a partner in an online business.
It's awesome. Yeah, I mean, it's really amazing for us. You know, me, I moved recently about a little bit less than a year ago was recording, but from China to Thailand. And yeah, I mean, basically, it's an amazing world and an amazing opportunity. And to be, being a parent as well as still being a business owner and running it mostly from anywhere. So I think a lot of our listeners are in that position. Some are maybe not yet or working towards that, but it's an amazing time, and I hope everybody gets that opportunity. So thank you so much, Wayne, for sharing about Being Ninjas. I think a lot of listeners are familiar with you guys, been around a while and doing well. Do you want to share a little bit about how you guys work or how people can find you?
Sure. So Being Ninjas, we deliver zero bookkeeping services, small business bookkeeping, coaching, and training. We could be found at beninjas.com. We have a course that we recently rolled out specific to e-commerce sellers, and also a second course that we designed specific to bookkeeping systems and processes for virtual assistants. As we identified in our build out of our initial course, that a lot of business owners were asking if we could train their virtual assistants to support a lot of their bookkeeping awesome. Activities. So we identified a course and designed one specific to the virtual assistant audience.
Perfect. Yeah, that sounds great. And we'll link up your site, and of course people can find you online. Wayne, thank you again. Enjoy your Friday evening. It's my Saturday morning. We're true hustlers, you know, and dads, but I think this was a great show, and thank you for sharing.
Awesome, Mike. It was a pleasure to be on. Thanks for having me.
Do you want first access to our cross-border summit? Do you want to engage and get on monthly calls with other amazing people in the community? Then definitely check out gfavip.com. This is a private community and benefits and discounts for those that are very much wanting to support and get involved with the community here at Global From Asia. It's a way to help the show continue, and we really appreciate all of those people that have been applying. It is application only. We want this to be about quality and important people in the cross-border business and e-commerce community. If you are interested to get involved with us, connect with me and other amazing people on monthly calls, private groups, and of course getting first dibs to the cross-border summit as well as discounts, definitely check it out, www.gfavip.com. All right, thank you, Wayne, so much for sharing your brain, taking that brain out, part of that brain, and putting it into the internet, onto a radio show or a podcast. I do appreciate that, and I hope others appreciate that. Definitely Bean Ninjas is a pretty awesome one. We cooperate with them at Unipro Consulting Limited, our partner company for a company registration in Hong Kong. So if you are interested in having some companies do your bookkeeping, keeping your books up to date, specifically within Xero and others, it would be very much appreciated if you check them out. You know, no affiliate links, no really incentive to do that, but you know, Merrill and others, I've watched them grow and develop over the years, so they're an amazing company that really helps their clients and especially e-commerce internet businesses to keep their books in order. So, of course, as in anything, you can do anything yourself. You can register companies yourself. You can do your bookkeeping yourself. You could do your sourcing yourself, your quality control yourself. You could do your payments. I guess you could do your payments yourself. You could stuff a suitcase of cash and fly to that place and give them a suitcase of cash. But as you hear in the show, we have different service providers and experts and consultants that can help business owners and traders do their business better, and Bean Ninjas is one of them. Thanks again for them contributing to the community. I'll do my blah 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 a little bit. I'm kind of on the road and doing this on a dining room table, so I will maybe not do 10 minutes, but bookkeeping is extremely important. I remember when I first started to do mine for my first e-commerce business, I think I didn't really do much more than Excel for 2004, which was mostly negatives, because when you start businesses, your sales are probably zero for a while, and it's mostly costs, but you still should track that. So we were tracking that, Andrew, my partner in that first business, and me in that studio apartment in Manhattan, New York City, 24th Street and 3rd Avenue, was Excel spreadsheet, and we had one computer that we shared when we started. It was my laptop. He didn't have a laptop, and we would just take turns using the computer, and what we did is an Excel spreadsheet. So that is obviously a critical first step. Of course, you don't got to spend money on Xero or QuickBooks, but a little bit for my blah 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 here and my use of bookkeeping, we then switched to QuickBooks, and that was before it was QuickBooks Online. That was when it was this software you had to spend like $200 or something, and it was like CDs. You had to install the software on your laptop or your computer, and we had no idea how to use this stuff. It was like overheating my, I don't know what laptop I had, Lenovo or IBM ThinkPad or some kind of crappy laptop that would reset if you unplugged it because the battery was burnt out on it. And so I found a QuickBooks consultant in Manhattan, and I forget her name. She was a nice woman, and she thought we were totally insane because it was like sometime in 2005. And we were like, can you help us? We installed this software, and I didn't know how to do chart of accounts and figure out what expense classifications for this or that. And, you know, I like to keep things funny, but, you know, look, one of the cool things about selling bar supplies online is those bar receipts are legitimate business expenses. So you had like tons of receipts of, you know, this bar, that bar. And we're like, what do we classify those in QuickBooks? T&E? Travel and entertainment? I guess that's a business expense. And, you know, anything can be a business. You know, you can really put anything as you know, in your books. Of course, people ask me, you know, with this trade war, can I say it's made in Hong Kong and send my Chinese goods from Hong Kong? You could do anything, you know. Yeah, I could forge documents and lie and say my factory's in Hong Kong and not mainland China. You could also take a business expense from a nightclub in Manhattan and say it's business development, but if it, you know, anything can be done. It's just if anybody asks, you know, and unfortunately, if you're too small, it's not worth the big dogs to bother you. But, you know, I'm trying to make this ending segment a little bit fun, but she thought we were insane with our huge envelope of receipts of nightclubs that had probably beer stains on it and other things. But we were trying to figure out how to put this into this amazing new software that was overheating my, I don't know, 1999 laptop from college, and trying to figure out how to enter transactions into it and what to put what. But, you know, I think the good thing about using a software instead of an Excel spreadsheet is it does make reports easier. Of course, you could do reports in Excel with like macros or all this other crazy stuff. But I think once you get to that point, and once you get the data into a Xero or a QuickBooks, you can then actually try to run reports, and then you can actually look at how many nightclubs have you gone for business purposes in the last month. Or you can see, you know, travel costs, how much you're spending on marketing, how much money you're giving Jeff Bezos and Amazon for your PPC ads compared to your product sales, and what is your real margins, and even some advanced stuff. Like if you can get the data, you can see what's your most profitable product, you know, and what's your most popular product. That might be a little bit tricky in even these accounting systems, because you'd have to pull in all your products into it. But all I'm trying to say is, you know, start with Excel. I don't want to, you know, we just had a workshop and there were some new entrepreneurs starting, and I remember, you know, don't get so complex at the beginning, but at least have the habit of trying to keep track of all those expenses and all those negative losses as you try to hustle and grind and build your first business or your current business or your new business. But if you're already doing it, you know, sometimes you're like, I didn't do accounting for the last 3 years, or I just gave bank statements to my accountant and hope I did it all right. But, you know, I'll be honest, I've been there with certain things I've done. Maybe you don't want to backdate the last 3 years, because maybe you don't want to pay a ton of money to a worker or a company like Bean Ninjas to go back in time. Maybe pick a date, or maybe pick a year. Maybe say January 1st, I'm going to go back to January 1st. Or maybe you're listening to this in December and you're like, what's my New Year's resolution? Maybe just start from the year going forward to have better accounting, better bookkeeping, better tracking. And one thing I like to say is maybe, you know, one good thing about having partners is accountability. Maybe your partners or your investors or your team have like a weekly report that you actually look at. Don't just put the numbers into a data system. Actually try to look at the numbers and think like, what is working, what's not working, you know, what is getting the biggest ROI? Is it my PPC on Amazon donating to the Amazon cause and the Amazon Foundation, or is it, you know, the Google ads or Facebook ads, or is it like trade shows, or is it maybe that cross-border summit ticket I bought, you know, and I invested in a cross-border summit. Maybe that was the best investment for my business that year. I made some business connections, I made some deals, I met some amazing people, I supported a podcast, stuff like that. You know, you got to look at all those costs, all those sales. What did get you the best ROI for your business? What was working and what wasn't working, and adjust, you know, maybe weekly, at least I would say monthly, and also quarterly. I do for the Sistano stuff. I make a quarterly report, and you don't have to get so crazy, right? What's your top line? What's your expense, total expenses? What's some one-time costs that maybe wouldn't be on recurring costs that hit the company or maybe positively impacted a company, but you shouldn't look at it as a regular thing. And then try to, you know, make that a simple report. Send it out to your team, send it out to different people. I think your job as the founder or the owner or the executive or the active person working in a company is to know your numbers, to know what's working, to know what's not, be able to actually present that clearly to others in the company, whether it's employees or whether it's partners or investors. You know, I think you got to know your numbers, know what's working, know what's not. So as much as you might be like me and be the artist and the creator and not into the numbers, it's your job if you want to really be a business owner is to run your numbers, know your numbers, and be able to present those numbers to others that need to see it. Especially, we've had other business brokers on the podcast, and I think Wayne even mentioned it in the show, if you ever want to sell your company or if you ever want to get investors, you have to be able to show numbers. You're going to ask, what's your numbers? So, and I know how it goes. You know, I know how it goes. Sometimes things get out of control and you get behind. But I think for at least if you want to sell your company or maybe raise money or something, at least you need a year at least, I think, but probably more like 2 years of pretty clear financials for them to look at before they probably would even consider investing or buying or partnering with you. So, you know, hustle if you're starting. Try to keep at least a spreadsheet. When you get a little bit of money and it gets a little bit more complicated, invest in some kind of software like QuickBooks and Xero, and there's some others. GoDaddy, we've had people on the show say, I actually have that for the Sysatano company. But any kind of software. And then if you got money, pay somebody, pay Bean Ninjas, pay some freelancer or hire somebody in your company or do it yourself. Probably doing it yourself is the best because you actually see the transactions and you're thinking about them as you're data entering that into your software. Or there's obviously auto imports, but if you just auto import, you still got to look at the numbers. I think looking at the numbers, looking at the report and thinking about it is the most valuable part. I hope this is helpful. I hope you enjoy the interview with Wayne. Thanks, Wayne, for coming on. And the blah, blah, blah segment at the end is over. And this show 255 Global from Asia is over. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.
To get more info about running an international business, please visit our website at www.globalfromasia.com. That's www.globalfromasia.com. Also, be sure to subscribe to our iTunes feed. Thanks for tuning in.